Father, forgive them. This day thou shalt be with me in paradise. Why hast thou forsaken me? I thirst. It is finished. Mother, behold thy son, and woman, behold thy son. Breathe thou, most Lord. Open our ears that we will hear what thou hast to say unto the church. In the sweet and precious name of your son who died for our sins, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
It's good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. It is so wonderful to be at this pulpit, a place wherein I was nurtured in the Lord. I haven't preached in a good while, Pastor. I've just been preaching all over the country. Just got back in town a few days ago. And I was almost ready to knock this old preacher out. He kept talking all this stuff about pastor. And I sat listening to him for a little while. And I said to him, I'm not going to beat you here, what I'm going to do, I rebuke you. In Jesus' name. Why are you rebuking me, Kilbo? I said, man, let me say something to you. I listen to you. I said, I remember. I used to come to work and try to beat pastor to the office. He would be here at 4:30 in the morning. Nobody was here. He'd be here till 1 o'clock in the morning, way after the tribe called Blessed that he was out here. And what he was doing was, he was trying to help the people of God at the Bethlehem Baptist Church. Yes, he was. I've seen the man do it. And I shared with that preacher, I said, man, I'm telling you, you really better be thanking God that I'm saved. Why do you say that, Kilgore? I say that because one day when I was, don't you hear me, this is real. I took the children to People's Baptist Church. Never forget this in my life. And I mean, the Holy Spirit was so thick there that night. I preached, and after the service, it was this gentleman who was European. He did one of these and spit in my face. And all the kids from the tribe saw it, and I wiped it off, and only because I had those kids with me. Horace said to me, Horace said, Doc, I said, no, let's just all get back in the van, amen, come on back. And I learned from them. You're right. Yeah, people will praise you.
Amen.
Yeah.
On Palm Sunday.
Yes.
But Good Friday's coming.
Yeah.
Now, I was not going to preach before I came here. I'm going to sit down and just chill. But the Lord has opened so many doors for me. This is my 30th year of ministry.
Yeah.
Ago, I was a young preacher under Pastor Weaver's tutelage. 1988, the Lord called me to preach, and I ran.
All right, man.
And they allowed me to preach my trial sermon in 1992. And so while I was sitting there, I said, Lord, what? Be honest with you, I was up all night, you know, trying to finish this assignment. Pastor wrote me a good recommendation and got me into a doctoral program at his school. And I don't know if I should praise him or strangle him. Yeah, I don't know what's wrong. I don't know if I should strangle him because the work is really hard. So I went to sleep last night. At my desk, woke up, it was 9 o'clock. My mother had to go to church and preach a funeral at 10. Don't know how I made it yesterday. I preached my aunt's funeral.
All right.
I haven't been long now. But while I was sitting there, the Lord said to me, your assignment, my assignment today, I'm coming after you. You're a millennial. I'm coming for you. That's sign. I'm coming for you. Yeah, you need the Lord badly. You're millennial. You need the Lord badly. Why? Because Jesus was 4 years from being a millennial when they killed him. He was 33 years old. Most of his ministry was in his millennial years. Somebody need to hear me. I'm going a different way. Zechariah, the third chapter. I want you to hear these words. And I'll begin with the first verse. Then he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to oppose him. And the Lord said to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is this not a brand plucked from the fire?" Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and was standing before the angel. Then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, "Take away the filthy garments from him." And to him he said, "See, I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich clothes." And I said, "Let them put a clean turban on his head." So they put a clean turban on his head, and they put on the clothes on him. And the angel of the Lord stood by. It is finished. Uh-huh. It's only just begun, young people.
All right,
yeah.
Jesus dies a young man.
Yeah.
In dying as a young man, he was always trying to reach those who were closest to him. And somehow or another, we've been trying to reach you if you're a millennial. All of my years in ministry, most of it has been spent trying to reach you. Even at the church where I pastor, I'm still trying to reach out to them. And I was preaching at Friendship in Charlotte. And when I looked out, I couldn't believe it. I saw Cam Newton in the choir with some shades on. And then there was this other young brother, he sings this song. "Send me your location, let's communicate, because I just need the time and place to come through." So I said to him, I said, "Pastor, is that Cam Newton?" "Yes, that's him." "He goes to your church?" "Yes, he does." I was like, "Bam, that's him." And then I see the brother who sings that song, "Send me your location." I was like, "Man, they're in church." What I'm trying to tell you, young people, Jesus has been trying to reach his disciples and those around him. But the reason why he could not reach them is because James and John were so caught up in their own self. "Lord, let me sit on the right side. And let my brother sit on the left side. And the rest of these young people, I'll forget them."
Well,
Jesus said, "No, no, no. Suffer the little children to come unto me. I've got a blessing for you." Now, if you're a millennial, it wouldn't seem like we live in a world where you could be blessed. We're living in a world now where it seems as though even if you came to church, somebody might get upset at the gospel of Jesus Christ and shoot you in the church. Not the church. Not here where the Holy Spirit reigns in the church. So here Jesus has been trying to get them to see. And maybe they didn't see or hear Genesis, the third chapter.
Come on.
He bruised the heel. You see, if I bruise your heel, that's not a deadly wound. But if I crush your head, Jesus has now crushed the head of the devil. When he dies, he crushes his head. Now, here's the thing. You millennials, there's too much that's been crushing you. How is it that you can pay $250 for a tattoo, but you won't pay $20 for anything in the church? So where's the location? The location is not only Jerusalem, but it's in the house of the Lord. That's where you get your blessing. Not only that, Jesus had crushed his head, but you, the live in this world, I was noticing when the kids were singing and when I'm preaching in these mega churches, folk are so crazy now, Pastor, that they are right now, they probably got on Facebook Live, they're on Instagram, they're on Twitter, they're everything. So that's why you can't preach somebody else's sermon, because these kids now will Google what you're saying.
Yeah.
The fulfilled victory,
yes, sir,
of Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. When I was down in Winston-Salem preaching at Union, they had it on the black radio station, thousands of people everywhere. And so they asked me, why do you proclaim this Jesus so much?
Uh-huh.
I said, the reason why I talk about Jesus is I've discovered that if I brag about Jesus,
yeah,
he'll back it up. The 49th chapter,
uh-huh,
and the 10th verse. The scepter, Lord, have mercy.
Uh-huh.
It says in the word,
yeah,
shall not what? Pass from Judah.
Right.
I'm mixing it up, but basically what that scripture does, it reminds us of Judah and Joseph. Uh-huh. And his brothers.
Yes.
You have to go back to Genesis 43 and 31, 32, 33. Joseph has now been blessed by God.
Yes.
Like you millennials are. Y'all got more, I call you cornucopia kids. You got more than you know what to do with. You got more money. You got more education. You got boys on, you're on Facebook. You got all kind of handles. But you don't have salvation. You don't have Jesus. And you can't go nowhere, young person, without the Lord. About 10 more minutes. Joseph wants to see the character of his young brothers.
Yeah.
He wanted to see if their heart had changed. So he sees, he asks, your father's still living. Text says he goes and cries. The scepter, or Judah, means praise.
Yeah.
And Shiloh, in this term, could have meant the place they worship, but they believed that the scholars believed that it was about the Messiah who was to come. Jesus now fulfills it all. He drops his head. He says it's finished.
Yeah.
But it's only just begun.
Yeah.
You see, folk right now are against the church. Folk right now don't want to hear about Jesus.
Yeah.
They don't want to hear gospel preaching. They don't want to hear it because some of us are preaching somebody else's message.
Yeah.
I don't have nobody else's sermon. All I got is the blood.
Yeah.
Of Jesus.
Yeah.
I told y'all I'm coming to get you. I'm going to my seat. But when I met the brother who sings that song, "Send Me Your Location," and I said to him, I said, man, I love that song. He's like, you're about the only preacher that I ever heard say, I love that song. I said, brother, I'm a little different. I got nothing in you. I said, but I wish I had the CD. I want you to sign it. So I pulled out a $20 bill to sign this. And I was telling Jesse Williams, I said, Jesse, man, look here. Don't you know he took my $20 bill? And bought some food with me. That's the world that you live in. My mentor said to me in the doctoral program, he said, Kilgore, we've been following your ministry. Said, we got some of your sermons that you preached years ago on Google Docs. I said, oh, is that right?
Wow.
So I said to him, he said, my final document was going to be called Faith Walk, the Odyssey of a Brother from the Hood. But they changed it to Faith Walk. the Odyssey of a Man from the East. Jesus is from the East. In the movie Black Panther, as I go to my seat, Wakanda is mythical, but heaven is real. Don't get caught up in Wakanda. Wakanda is a myth.
That's right.
What I'm talking about is eternal. Heaven is real.
That's right.
So they take Chadwick and they have this plant, if you will, that has some kind of whatever it is in it, mythical power. And they lay him down. They lay him down and somehow he comes back to life. All I'm saying is Jesus wants you to lay down all that sin you're dealing with. He wants you to lay down all them brothers who tell you you're fine. He wants you to take all them brothers and tell them men that you think look good. Lay all of that down. It really does not matter. And when you lay it down, on the third day. On that third day, he'll come up and rise up in you. Here's the location. The location is 71.
Go ahead.
Look out. And if you're a millennial, it's time for you to come on in the house. Come on in the room. There's some anointing in this room. For me, a little boy from East New York, locked in a priest of tens of thousands, scared in my seat, but he said, come on.
Come on.
Come on in the room.
Yeah.
Come on in the room. It'll be all right.